cave. 40 days, only a spark to light my way. I wanna give out, I wanna give in. This is our crime, this is our sin. But I still believe, I still believe. Through the pain and through the grief, through the lies, through the storms, the cries, and through the wars, oh, I still believe. Back out at sea, hoping these waves don't cover me. I'm turned and tossed upon the waves. When the darkness comes, I feel the grave. But I still believe, I still believe. Through the cold and through the heat, through the rain, the tears, through the crowds, and through the cheers, oh, I still believe. This road, I'll climb this hill upon my knees if I have to. I'll take my place upon this stage. I'll wait till the end of time for you, like everybody else. Woo! I still believe, through the shame and through the grief, through the heartache and through the tears, through the waiting and through the years, for people like us in places like this, we need all the hope that we can get. Oh, I still believe.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Branch Brothers. It's me, Seth. Let's get Rick on the call, and we can start the real podcast. Hello.
Hello there.
So, what do you want to cover this week?
I am covering the books of Daniel and Ezekiel.
Ooh, nice.
Yeah, so a lot more talk on Exile today.
I am going to be covering my experience with spiritual warfare and what I've read of the Intercessor's Handbook. I am now like 2 hours in out of six, so one third of the way through the book. Actually, no, I don't know the exact length of it, but I'm getting there, slowly but surely.
Nice. All right.
Should I go first, or do you want to start?
I think I've been going first the past couple weeks, so I think to change things up, how about I go first?
Sounds good to me.
Perfect. All right, so I'm going to start with Daniel, because, as we all know, when the southern kingdom of Judah was conquered by the Babylonians took the people out in about three different waves. And so, Daniel actually focuses on the very first wave of exile, and we're going to start there. Daniel mainly consists of two segments. The first half focuses on narrative, telling the story of the first wave of exile, as well as Daniel and his friends' experience over there. And the second half focuses a lot on various visions that Daniel received while he was in Babylon. So I'm going to go a bit more in detail the first half. So the story begins at the beginning of the first exile, where the Babylonians attack the kingdom of Judea, which at this point was the only kingdom left, and they basically take a handful of stuff, and they take some of the people from the highest classes, like the royal king's family, some of the nobles, the clergymen, basically a lot of the high-profile people they were taking in the first wave. This included Daniel and his friends. And what's interesting is that all four of them had names that referenced God in some way, shape, or form. But...
Right, because if I remember correctly, wasn't Daniel friends with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego?
Yes, that was their names, actually. And what's interesting is that... those names you mentioned are after originally, because that was actually their Babylonian name. When they were in Judah, before they were taken away, their names were originally... So Shadrach was originally Hananiah. Mishael was originally Mishael, as in Kalel. And then Abednego was originally Azariah. And what's fascinating about this is that all four of these people... I forgot what Daniel's Babylonian name was. I think it was... my brain kind of blanked. But basically, what's interesting about these name changes is that they were changed from names that referenced God to names that referenced the Babylonian pagan gods. And I think this was done by the Babylonians to try to strip them away of their Jewish heritage. But one of the core lessons in Daniel is that it essentially teaches people how to live your faith in a land that is hostile to your values. Which in this case, you know, was Babylon, which had their own religion, and they tried to essentially force their beliefs onto the people of Judah, but Daniel's friends didn't give in. In fact, there was an incident where they had some, like, the king of Babylon made some kind of idol, basically, and he had a decree where, like, if the horn goes off, everything would have to bow to it. But none of Daniel's friends did that. So they were told, hey, I'm going to do this again. Another time this happens again, I'm going to have you killed. And they're like, well, it doesn't matter because you may be the king, but our God is far more powerful than you are. And no matter what happens, even though they fear, because he is with us. And even if something happens, he can protect us. And even if, like, we were to die, he will still be with us. So we have nothing to fear. And this basically made the king so angry, he essentially threw him into a furnace to burn him alive. But miraculously enough, none of them died. In fact, when the king looked inside the furnace, he saw not three, but four figures.
Right, and the fourth being described as the Son of God. There's a bit of confusion, actually, due to that translation, because, wait a minute, isn't Jesus the Son of God? Isn't he supposed to be, like, New Testament dude? And yes, that's why more recent translations have actually done away with that phrasing and replaced it with, there's a being of light in there, and it's more clearly shown that that entity was an angel.
Yeah, the entity is in fact an angel, but I would argue that the reason why Nebuchadnezzar could refer to him as a son of God is because maybe from his point of view, he knew it was a divine being. He just didn't know what exactly it was. And keep in mind, they don't believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, so they're probably thinking it's some God, son of a God rather than son of the God, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's also true.
Yeah, that's more to point there. And then basically after that, Daniel himself was tossed into lions after he refused to give in to idolatry. And essentially, he was in the... I think what had happened was Daniel had actually a pretty good relationship with one of the kings of Babylon, and there were some advisors who were jealous of Daniel because he and his friends were high-ranking people, but they weren't Babylonians. They were Jewish. And so they created this plan where... if they worship any god other than like the main Babylonian gods, they'd be tossed in the lion's den. And they did some kind of pact where like the king would have to toss anyone in. And because Daniel was worshiping God, that violated the rule. So he had to get tossed in the lion's den at the king's disgruntlement. Because he didn't really want to do it, but because of the agreement, he had to. It's one of those kind of situations.
Yeah, and it's the king realizes that this was basically concocted by these advisors to trick him into executing Daniel, and he was not happy about it.
Oh, absolutely not.
Because when they came back several days later and found Daniel still alive, the king's like, you know what? I'm going to throw you guys in there instead, because this was really not cool on your guys' part to trick me like this.
Yeah, and then lo and behold, as soon as he did that, they all died.
Yeah.
Alright, so then basically, this is actually around the time where the thing ends. Basically, the narrative portion essentially ends with Daniel in a higher level court. So by the time the Persians come in, he's still in, I believe he's still in the high court as of like the return time period when they start coming back. He's still in the high level, so that's where he basically ends up before the people start coming back from Babylon, before the Persians come in.
Right.
And then the half of Daniel is basically a bunch of prophecies, dreams that Daniel saw while he was in Babylon. A lot of them actually dealt with not so much the Persians, but actually the most famous vision he had over there was actually a dream that he interpreted on behalf of King Nebuchadnezzar, where he saw the statue made of like gold, silver, bronze, and like iron and clay.
Yeah.
And basically Daniel was able to interpret the dream and how it was. It actually represented the four kingdoms. The gold, the head of gold, was Babylon. These arms and breastplate of silver was Persia, the Medo-Persian Empire. The legs of bronze were Greece, and then the iron was Rome. The iron mixed in clay was like Rome, but later on when it became weaker, and then it basically ended with the mountain coming up and destroying all the statues and crumbling into pieces, and that would represent the church, the one true church that Christ would establish on this earth, which would triumph all the empires, would be the one true kingdom that have dominion over the earth.
And it's funny because if you know your history, the church was actually kind of responsible for keeping the lights on after Rome fell in that region. When Western Rome fell, you really had Byzantium, and then you had these fractured territories that were ruled by the barbarian tribes that had taken over, be it Germanic, Franco, what have you. And the people who were local to that region basically had to deal with the people who were ruling that, and the conquerors were not nice to the people they were subjugating, as it usually goes with history. The reason that Catholicism is so big in that region to this day is because the Catholic Church, the early church, were the ones keeping things in order in those wild regions, essentially.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I believe when the Roman Empire fell, the church actually ruled 2/3 of all that land. Because by the time Roman fell, the church already spread so wide and far, combined with the fact that it became the main religion of Rome several centuries prior to the decline, they had the resources necessary to govern a massive landmass and maintain the status quo, shall we say, in many ways.
Yeah, and you know, it was partly because of that stabilizing force that the church offered that Byzantium lasted so dang long as well. I can't remember if Byzantium was a Orthodox or Catholic-aligned region, though. This might have been before the split, come to think of it.
Yeah, I think so. Now, where was I? Yeah. Actually, that part about the dream was actually in the narrative part, which is the first half of Daniel. The second half actually focused a lot more on, like, the near future was to come, mainly on Greece, actually. Like, Daniel was able to accurately predict not only the Persians coming in and being Babylon, but also the Persians being beaten by the Greeks, specifically Alexander the Great. He predicted that he specifically would come in and defeat Persia. He predicted that he would rule over the Persian Empire. He saw his death, Alexander's death, in the visions, and he also foresaw what would happen immediately after his death, how all the generals basically took control of different provinces of the land, effectively split the Greek Empire from that point forward. Like, everything that Daniel saw in those visions essentially came to pass. What was so astonishing was that he was getting these visions while Babylon was still the worldly power. Persia hadn't even come in yet by that
point. Yeah, Daniel was seeing things like thousands of years after his time, essentially. Or not rather, he was he had insight on this, and the king was seeing it. It's a good showcase of how God really chooses to give information when the way prophecies I've seen in the Bible and in real life, they're kind of delivered on a need to know basis, essentially. God knows the most effective means to communicate that messages to people, and he knows just who to be the messenger as well.
Oh, precisely, yeah. You know, we gotta keep in mind, God knows the whole story from start to finish, and he knows who needs to speak at what time, because he knows who can best do it, who's best equipped for the job. He's basically the best hire ever, because he picks, like, exactly the right people that are needed for these particular moments, whether it was before the Age of the Divided Kingdom, during the Exile, in the Age of the Return, it didn't matter. He always found the right people, and he knew who exactly to call for that moment, even when the people in question felt they were unqualified,
yeah,
or didn't want to do it in some cases.
There's an old saying that I'm rather fond of: God is a picker of fools.
You know, I have another saying I like to say. I've said this in the past too, but like, God does not call the qualified; he qualifies the call.
Yeah.
Now, the interesting thing about Daniel is there's one extra tip I want to mention. So I know in the past we talk about the Deuterocanonical books and how the Catholic and Protestant Bibles have, like, different their Old Testaments, essentially. And what's unique about the book of Daniel is actually one of two books that are in both canons but have additional content not found in the Protestant version. And I want to briefly touch on that as well.
By all means, go ahead.
So the first one is actually in chapter 3 of Daniel. Remember the part where they tossed Daniel's friends to the furnace?
Yeah.
Well, basically, what it had was there's that extended section where what was his name again? Abednego basically has a prayer where he prayed to God in the midst of fire, asking that if God had mercy, that he would, like, save them. And basically, he does. Because while this was going on, this prayer, they tried raising the furnace to make sure they were burned. It was getting so hot, it was actually burning people who were near the furnace alive. They were burned alive.
Oof.
But, like, the people inside were not. And, like, as this was going on, because they noticed they were being saved, and they saw the angel there, too, who had approached them and was with them, all three of them basically said this long, beautiful prayer, basically giving glory to God, for his majesty endures forever. And that's exactly what they said for about 30 verses, I believe.
Dang.
And this is a little right before King Nebuchadnezzar saw him in the thing, and that's when he saw, oh, shoot, they're still alive. And after that, he would... Now, this is actually in the part that's involved, because this is the part where, like, okay, your god's clearly real, so whoever makes fun of their god, they will be punished. And that was the decree going forward. But yeah, so that first part wasn't as crazy. It just expanded on one of the parts in the story, in the narrative portion. Now, the other half was very, very interesting. So we have two additional chapters at the end of Daniel, chapters 13 and 14. Now, in the Apocrypha, these are actually listed as separate books, but in this case, it's just Elizabeth or Daniel. So the first one deals with a woman named Susanna, and basically, oddly enough, also shares the same name as my older sister, so that's interesting. Anyway, what had happened was this person, Susanna, was married to a dude, and she was just another Jew, you know, minding her business. And then there were basically these two priests who had basically were lusting after her and wanted to, like, do things to her.
Oh,
now,
no.
At first, they weren't aware of each other's desires. Once they found out, they basically tried to come up with a plan to essentially try and have their way with her. So one day, she goes off and she's, you know, in the bathing in the garden, just bathing in like, the little pool there, and she sent her maids away. Then the priests, who were hiding in the bush this whole time, they come out of the bush and they basically say, we're have a desire for you, and we want you to lie with us. And if you don't lie with us, we're going to tell the whole town that you were cheating on your husband and basically have you killed. And rather than giving it to their demand, she basically screams like a banshee, and naturally being afraid, the priest basically ran out the door and pushed the doors wide open because they didn't want to, you know, get caught in there. And so everyone comes in, they're like, hey, what the heck happened? And they basically told everyone what they said. It was like, oh, this one was cheating on her husband, she's being unfaithful, we need to stone her. And these people were getting ready to stone her because they, you know, these guys weren't just nobodies. They were the elders. They were like the chief priest. They were like high level people.
Jeez, just when you think it can't get any worse.
Yep. And Zan was like freaking out. She's like, she's praying to God, like, Lord, you know, please help me. Don't let this happen. You know, I'm innocent. And this is where Daniel comes in. He basically shows up and through essentially an individual cross examination, because he examined the two elders separately and he knew they were lying because when he asked her, because one of their claims was that they saw her lying with another man under a tree. When he asked them a tree, they actually gave different answers. One guy said they did under a sycamore tree. The other guy said they did under a maple tree. And because of that, he basically exposed them for being the liars that they were. So instead of her getting stoned, they instead stoned the two elders. And they were shamed and stoned. So they got the punishment she would have gotten had she been found guilty. But because of Daniel's intervention, Susanna's life was spared. And she got to live with her husband and family in peace. Now, I believe this chapter, given there's no reference to Babylonians in this chapter, I believe it actually takes place before the rest of the book of Daniel, specifically Daniel chapter 1, since these are elders of Israel, I mean, in Judah, so there would be no Babylonians there. But it goes to show how, even in Judah, there was that sort of firmness in the faith, like, no, I'm going to stay first to the Lord, I'm not going to, like, give my way into these, like, guys, even if they are elders, I'm going to stick to what I know to be right. And these guys were sleeping with a bunch of other women, too, who were married. They were essentially using their power to essentially have their way with other people in the kingdom.
Ugh.
Yeah, really sleazeballs. There's something that irks me more than, like, people who use their power to harm others.
Judah, like Joseph's older brother?
Oh, I know what you're referring to, but no. When we refer to Judah, we're talking about the tribe of Judah, or in this case, the kingdom of Judah. This is actually, it's a long story short, but basically, there was originally one kingdom called Israel, but they split in half. Judah is the southern kingdom. More accurately, it's called Judea, I should say. But this is the southern kingdom of, like, Israel. So there's that. But yes, there is Joseph does have a brother named Judah, but that was way earlier. That's all the way back in Genesis. So
yeah.
That was quite a ways a while ago.
Yeah, if I remember correctly, this is, what book is this?
This is the book of Daniel.
Okay. I'm trying to remember if that's before or after Psalms. I'm still on Psalms.
Well, most of the Psalms were actually written during the time of King David, so probably around the age of the Royal Kingdom. So I would say probably the Psalms were written mostly during the events of, I would say, like, 2 Samuel / 1 Kings /
Okay, so I'm probably behind now. Crap.
Nah, it's fine, my dude. It happens. Now, I want to briefly talk about the other chapter, because this is actually chapter 14. This actually takes place in exile, and this involves Bel and the Dragon. So Bel and the Dragon were basically two different idols that were worshipped in Babylon. So I'm going to start with Bel and then go to the Dragon.
Oh,
so
Baal. I thought I was mishearing you for a second.
No, Bel. B-E-L. Bel, as in ringing bell. But basically, Bel was an idol that was worshipped in Babylon, and the king commanded Dan to worship it. But Daniel would say no, because it's just a statue. It's not even alive. It's a thing. But Bel eats and drinks. How can you say that if he eats and drinks? And he goes, okay, I'm going to prove it. And basically what he does is, before he leaves, he basically spread a bunch of ashes all over the floor where the altar was. And there's a reason why. I'll get to that in just a bit. So basically, what they thought was the god eating and drinking was that the priests who were serving this Bel would actually sneak in the middle of the night with their wives and children through a secret cubbyhole that was right over where the altar was. They would come out, and then they would eat and drink the stuff that was there in the middle of the night. So that way in the morning, it looked like Bel was eating, it was actually people eating it. And so after Daniel does this little thing, they do the same as before, right? They come into the secret hole, they eat the food and drink, and they sneak. But this time around, when the king and Daniel walk in, they go, see, the Bel was eating. He's clearly wise. You got to worship him. And he goes, Your Highness, why don't you look at the floor? They look at the floor, and they see footprints all over the area near the altar. Not only that, they find a secret cubbyhole where the priests were. They actually had the priest show them where it was, and when the king found out, he was so mad, he basically put that whole group to death. The priests with their wives and children put them all to death for what they were doing.
You know what's... it's funny that you bring this part up, because... last Monday, I was actually watching a video on, like, the various, basically, idols that the surrounding regions outside of the kingdoms of Israel worshipped. There's some scary stuff. Like, we're roasting on Baal right now because, you know, this is funny. This is roastable material. But there was some scary shit that went on in the other religions outside of Judea.
Oh, yeah, there's so many of them. We got Molech, we got Baal, probably the most infamous one.
Asherah is an interesting case as well. Molech's fucking scary.
Yeah, Molech's terrifying. We'll cover more of those pagan gods in a bit, but let's wrap up this part on Daniel real quick, and then we can continue there.
Yeah.
So after the bell, there was also a dragon that the people were worshipping. Daniel basically defeats the dragon, and then it dies, essentially.
Wait. That wasn't... So, this isn't a fucking statue where people are just, like, bowing down to... There's a fucking dragon?
I don't know if it's, like, a dragon, like, European dragon. Probably more of, like, a giant lizard, essentially.
Yeah,
but
probably.
But, yeah, it was a living creature. It was a living creature that they worshipped. And Daniel was able to prove that it wasn't divine, so they didn't worship it. But the people who worshipped the dragon got so mad that they had Daniel tossed to a lion's den again. So this is the second time this happens. And then while he's there, he's also there for 6 days. But here's the interesting part. Remember the prophet Habakkuk?
Oh, vaguely. Wasn't he the guy that got killed because he told some people stuff they didn't want to hear?
No, I think Habakkuk was... If I recall... No, that was Hosea. Habakkuk was the one who... he was the one who was telling people that there would be a time for war, essentially. I believe that was him. I might be mistaken, but I think that's what it was known. I know it was one of the minor prophets that showed around the time of the exile. I believe that was him. But essentially, he was minding his business back in Judea because he had not been exiled. He was still alive at this point. And an angel was saying, hey, Daniel's in trouble and he's starving. I need you to give him some food. And Habakkuk goes, well, I'd love to help, but I'm here today, and he's all the way in Babylon. There's not much I can do. So the angel basically grabs him by the head, by the temple of his hair, flies all the way to Babylon, drops him right in front of the den, and goes, okay, go feed Daniel. So Habakkuk's like, hey, Daniel, I got your food. So he drops off the food to Daniel. Daniel eats that. And then after he gets the food to Daniel, the angel basically picks him up and brings him back to Judea. And then after that... They go back a couple days later, they find Daniel alive, and just like before, the king took the people who put Daniel there, tossed him the lion's den, they all immediately died.
So I just googled Habakkuk and was reading through his, what happened, and it's short. Essentially, he was like, Lord, what's with this place? You are all powerful, why is this evil allowed? And the Lord's answer essentially summed up as, don't worry, it's coming.
Yes, now I remember. Yes, that he was that prophet. And then that book actually ends with him praying on behalf of the people. That was the third chapter. It was three chapters, I remember that.
Yeah, basically you have Habakkuk's complaint, Lord's answer, and then Habakkuk's second complaint. His second complaint being, Lord, are you not from everlasting? My God, my Holy One, you will never die. You, Lord, have appointed them to execute judgment. You, my rock, have ordained them to punish. Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrongdoing. When then do you tolerate the treacherous? Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up the more righteous than themselves? You have made people like the fish in the sea creatures that have no ruler. The wicked foe pulls all of them up with hooks. He catches them in his net. He gathers them in his dragnet, and so he rejoices and is glad. Therefore he sacrifices to his net and burns incense to his dragnet. For by his net he lives in luxury and enjoys the choicest food. Is he to keep on enjoying his net, destroying nations without mercy? And the thing you gotta understand about this complaint is that it's mostly allegorical. It's saying there are people doing evil, profiting off of those who are good by exploiting them or robbing them. How is this allowed?
Yeah, but we do have to keep in mind, and God doesn't say this to Habakkuk, is that God's ways are greater than man. He knows the whole story. So while wickedness may thrive for a time, it won't last forever, and those who commit it and don't repent will not escape justice on the other side of eternity.
Yeah.
But yeah, now that we covered Daniel, I do want to talk about the book of Ezekiel as well, because he's actually the second of the three major prophets that are covered in the Bible. He was actually sent away during the second wave of exile. So by this point, it's after Daniel was sent away, but before the third and final wave, so right in the middle. And it actually starts with him on the day he was supposed to start his priesthood, because Ezekiel was actually from the tribe of Levi. So he was spending his whole life before that deciding to be a priest, and on the day he was supposed to be ordained, he gets sent off to exile in Babylon.
Oof.
Yep, and he basically, this is where he actually sees a vision of, like, all those different angels, like the seraphim, the one with the wheels, and all that stuff, and that's around the time that God declares him a prophet, that he would speak to the people about what's to come. And Ezekiel is often known as the weird prophet, because he was the one that would do all these, like, crazy stuff, like putting on a sackcloth, he would shave like half his head, he'd put like weird toys together. Like, it didn't make sense out of context, but when you pay attention to prophecies, you look at God's explanation, it actually makes a heck of a lot of sense. Most of it had to do with the fact that, like, of what was to come, because when the people were sent away, they were pretty bummed about being in Babylon because they weren't home anymore, but they were like, you know, there's still plenty of people left in Judea, and hopefully we can get back home. But Ezekiel was very interesting in what he communicated with God, where it's like, yeah, you're going to come home, but it's not going to be right now. In fact, there's essentially going to be one more wave of exile that's going to be bigger than the last two, and you'll be away for some time. You'll be able to return, but it's going to be a long time before you'll be able to come back. And what was one of the most crazy things there is that he actually sees a vision of the temple, and he saw essentially all the wickedness that was being committed there, the idolatry, the paganism, all that going on. And he saw the presence of God leaving the temple, which is very, very shocking, because prior to that moment, God had entered that temple. It was built by Solomon. It was the idea was that he would never leave the people, that they would go to the temple and he would save them, but they weren't really doing it. So, you know, God basically lets you remove his presence from there.
Right.
And then shortly after that, his wife would pass away. And the way he reacted was very interesting, because when his wife died, God basically told him, don't morph your wife the way most people usually would. Just act super neutral, act as if nothing else is going on. And so he goes ahead and he does this. He acts as if he's not in pain, he acts as if he's not hurt, and the people ask him, oh, Ezekiel, your wife just passed away, why are you acting like nothing happened? And then he basically tells them, because this is exactly how you're going to react when the temple falls. Like, you're not going
to... Ouch.
Yep, and lo and behold, the third and everything came to pass, right? The temple would fall, the third and final wave of exile happened, and he learns this from the guy from Jerusalem who managed to escape before the chaos happened. Like, no, the temple failed. Judah has fallen. We're being sent away again.
Ezekiel is that one guy in a disaster movie who realizes bad stuff's coming and gets out of town weeks before shit goes sideways.
Yeah, there's another prophet I'm going to cover later who does something relatively similar, although he wasn't as lucky in terms of escaping. We'll talk about him later. But basically, with Ezekiel's case, it falls down, and God basically tells him, it's kind of sad, where he's like, you know, the people are going to listen to you, they'll hear what you have to say, but they're not going to, like, take it in, they're not going to actually process it. And so his words eventually fall on deaf ears. Like, you saw it to the people, they're not really paying attention, which kind of sucks, because, like, try to teach them something, and it just seems like they don't care.
Yeah.
Really crappy outcome.
Although I've noticed that that's kind of a common occurrence for prophets in the Old Testament. Not, it's...
Yeah. People don't listen until after the fact. I mean, that's not even the case back then. In the New Testament, a lot of the Pharisees didn't seem to understand what the prophets were. It's certainly not true of the Sadducees. They didn't worship the first five books of Moses.
That is very... They are the textbook example of what not to do.
Pretty much. And actually, the book of Ezekiel, the last couple chapters actually focus on one last vision Ezekiel has, where he sees a new temple. What's interesting about this temple is that this thing has never been built on Earth. Not only does it not resemble the second temple that was built when the people came back, But there's been nothing like it that matches the description as told in the book of Ezekiel. In fact, one of the leading theories is that this temple is actually one that we'll see in heaven upon the restoration of the world. The new heaven, new earth, we'll see this temple in that reality, but it's not going to show up here. Another big allegory is that the temple is actually represented of Jesus himself, and how at the end of the book, there's a part where a thing of water comes out of the temple and creates a stream that flows outward. And this is an allegory for how when Jesus was stabbed with a spear, water and blood came gushing out of his like left side. And that's the same side the temple is leaking out of in that thing. Another crucial thing I want to bring up is
I never noticed that before.
Yeah. Because here's the thing. Because one of the ways to read the Bible is a sort of... understand. Because remember, the New Testament is hidden in the Old, and the Old Testament is revealed in the New. So whenever you're reading the Old Testament especially, keep an eye out for certain things that pop up. Because you'll know, if you pay attention close enough, you'll see parallels between what happened back then and what happens in the Gospel and by extension the rest of the New Testament.
Yeah. Yeah, good point.
Yeah, one last thing I want to mention about the temple before we move on to your topic is that there's actually three corridors in the building, one that goes south, north, and east. And what's interesting is that people who came in south, they exited the temple north. The people who came from the north exited the temple south. The idea here is that when you go to Mass and you go to church, you can't just go back the way you came. You can't be the same person you were in Mass versus out of Mass. The idea is that when you go to Mass, you're supposed to change, transform, and renew, and prepare to continue the work of the Lord as you leave the temple. And that continues out there. It should be a transformative experience. I think that was the idea there.
Yeah, I vaguely remember hearing, God, what was it? Somewhere I read about, like, how churches used to be built a certain way because of just the idea of how the building was also supposed to reflect the people, the process of people coming and going in and out of it. Obviously, you don't see that much thought put into the architecture of church nowadays.
Depends on which branch of the tree we're talking about, of course. Because some people literally worship in, like, porn.
Yeah, I've, it's commonly joked about the, about Baptists that we, that anywhere is a church if you're devoted enough. One joke on Redeemed Zoomer's channel is like, oh yeah, church is in the back of the Applebee's if you're a Baptist. It's like... kind of, but not, you're missing the point for comedic effect. But I get it.
Bro, imagine like you're going to Applebee's, you just see people like worshiping in a prayer circle. Like, what is going on here?
That's not the weirdest thing. Funny thing, if I actually saw that, that still wouldn't be the weirdest prayer circle I've ever seen. I saw a photograph of three dudes just doing a prayer circle in the back of an alleyway somewhere. Context, this was are you familiar with no stay on focus, Seth, we can talk about that part later. Fuck, sorry.
Yeah, if it's too unrelated, we can either talk about that.
I'm going off in a tangent and I've gotta stay focused.
All right, that's good, that's very good. I'm glad to keep yourself in check. Well, since we do have another podcast, keep in mind, so if anything happens, we can have it there.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, that's the gist of it. Yeah, that's basically it. That's a brief Ezekiel Nestle. Definitely an interesting tale, and I think it's a really great way to start to tie the first and second waves together, because Daniel's, I think, as far as I'm aware, is the only book that focuses on the first wave. A lot of the books either focus on the second wave or the third wave, depending on like which prophet you're reading about.
Yeah.
Or it even could have been important as well. There's a lot of, like, different parts here.
Shoot, even Kings kind of jumps from these kings were assholes to Wave 2 and 3. It doesn't really talk about Wave 1.
Yeah, and you're right. I don't remember any time about the first wave either. I think a lot of that conflict came exclusively with Daniel, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, so Daniel's actually really helpful for understanding, like, just how... just the process that was going on and how much... chaos and uproar this caused in the region at the time.
Mm-hmm. It's, in many ways, it's kind of like the Book of Tobit, where it gives an account that most of the Bible doesn't really discuss, which is really important to know because it can help to give you a greater understanding of the entire narrative structure of the Bible, the whole biblical history that the story is trying to tell.
Yeah. I will say, I always found the intro to Ezekiel funny. Imagine this dude trains his entire life to be a priest, gets carried off, and is like, God, I want to be a priest. And God just shows up like, yes.
No, now you're going to be a priest. You're going to be a prophet.
Yeah, literally. God just shows up and is like, yes.
But as we discussed earlier today, God chooses his messengers. Ezekiel was the guy for the job at that moment in time.
Absolutely. So now we move on to my topic, this spiritual warfare. This week, like any other, I experienced the pull of sin and temptation. What set it apart was what happened when I tried to fight it. Instead of praying to overcome this, I gave a my actions just spontaneously felt more guided and directed. I gave a defiant statement towards the devil. I heard my voice echoing through my mind as if amplified by something, or more accurately, someone. I said, no. I am Seth Kendrick Hackley. I am God's chosen hero. I am appointed by God as chief of heroes. I am the man God made me to be. I am the servant of the one true God Most High. Now leave this place and never return. The devil grumbled in response but left. My only reaction was, as soon as that was over, my immediate reaction was, I sat there and I was like, and I just said out loud, what on earth was that? I technically already knew the answer, as it's obvious that what I had just experienced was an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Admittedly, though, this was the first time I'd ever encountered it in a spiritual battle. Most of my encounters with the Holy Spirit were in the context of being inspired to do or write something, or be filled with calm and otherworldly joy. This was the first time I'd ever seen the Holy Spirit come over me in a battle against sin's influence, in spite of calling for such assistance numerous times before. And this has made me realize what probably should be the first lesson in about spiritual warfare. That being, God will fill you with the Holy Spirit and help you in your battles against the devil, but he does so when he sees it fit to do so. As God will use our falling short to instruct us that he doesn't take away our problems, he gives us the strength to overcome them. Once you truly understand this, then he will act. How often I've said in prayer, God, I can't defeat this on my own. I need you to help me overcome it. And often, I've only been met with silence or reminders of mercy rather than God's assurance of help to stop the problem at its source. In the Intercessor's Handbook, the author recounts in the second chapter about her experience with spiritual warfare. After joining the church that the leader of her local varsity team attended, she was invited to a weekly meeting that took place at the members' homes. And Jennifer states that it was one of these meetings that made her aware of how spiritual warfare is part of a Christian's life. Now, interestingly, Jennifer claims that she began to sense an impending demonic presence in the weeks prior to this, and she recognized it as she recognized its familiarity as she had experienced sensing demons before becoming a Christian as a child, and especially as a teenager, due to taking part in occult practices that she did not know were wrong at the time. Curiously, she doesn't name or describe these occult rituals she had involved herself in, but due to the familiarity she demonstrates with the occult in other chapters, I'm inclined to believe she's telling the truth. During the prayer meeting, Jennifer claims that the group was in prayer. As the group was in prayer, one of the other women present looked right at her, saying, "I see a spirit of sorcery standing over you." And what happened immediately after sounds like something from a schlock film about exorcisms. Jennifer was thrown backwards in her chair up against the wall as she and she claims to have lost contact with her surroundings and exhibit symptoms that looked like a grand mal seizure, with the added flare of demonic voices coming from her mouth. In spite of the fact that each of the women present in the prayer group were versed in spiritual warfare, none of them could help Jennifer, and they all more or less had to ride the whole thing out until the activity subsided several hours later. According to Jennifer, the next few weeks were filled with strange occurrences. She suffered nightmares, the doors of her closet and bedroom would rattle violently, when she was passing by windows she would hear sounds of knocking. And apparently this was not limited to just her, but anyone who was around her would notice this as well. Jennifer persisted in prayer, and one day she was so filled with faith that she gave a defiant statement of faith of her own to the demon. I will never serve you. I will only serve Jesus Christ. This is what set Jennifer on the path of an intercessor. As you might have realized by now, if going to battle against demonic influence, we are most effective when we are adamant, firmly rooted in faith, and devoted to serving God. Jennifer goes on to state that this experience left her with the understanding and authority to work against demonic influence. In the following chapter, she outlines how intercessory prayer is separate from devotional prayer. Intercessory prayer is rooted in our authority granted through Jesus. When God made the earth and set man on it, he gave man authority over the world and everything in it. That authority was robbed from mankind when sin entered the world, and was wrangled back from the devil when Jesus died for the sins of man on the cross. This is an important part of what the Bible talks about when it says that those who become Christ's followers are anointed as priest, prophet, and king. In acknowledging Jesus as the Son of God and as being fully God and fully man, as having died for the sins of man, we acknowledge his authority, and in so doing, by being dedicated to him and opening ourselves to him, are granted that authority to cast out the works of the devil and his underlings. Intercessory prayer is what is what we do when we pray on behalf of a brother or sister. We lift them up to God because we understand that through him they can be delivered from what troubles them. Whereas devotional prayer is something we do to maintain an active relationship with God. To those of you who believe but do not think yourself worthy to bear blessings God has given to all of those who acknowledge who he is, Jennifer outlines that even when the world was in a state of absolute sin, after Eden but before Jesus, several times in the Old Testament God looks at man and deliberates with his prophets. In the time of Sodom and Gomorrah, God speaks with Abraham about the fate of the cities, and it is Abraham who intercedes, asking God to spare the cities for the sake of the good people in them. God saying, "Even if I can find as few as 10 good people, I will not destroy the cities." Sadly, God only found 4, those being Lot and his family. But this demonstrates that even in times of God's anger, he will not let that anger spill over onto those who did no wrong, as he allowed Lot to flee with his family. In the next chapter, Jennifer recounts how she came to understand that supernatural problems require supernatural solutions. Some years after starting down the path of an intercessor, Jennifer had married and begun to attend a church with her husband that had a high turnover rate for the pastors serving there. There was also a strange practice that people attending had adopted, where they would dedicate structures, walls, rooms, and anything really to those who had recently passed, making the church feel less like a place that was meant to give life and more like a monument to death. There were some pastors who tried to solve the problems on a surface level by working on the interpersonal issues of the congregation, but this would never lead to any lasting change, and ultimately culminated in one pastor's hospitalization from stress, and he ended up leaving that church. Shortly after this incident, Jennifer found herself reading a book on Scandinavian occultism. She claims that the book caught her attention due to her being from that region, and most of the congregation being likewise. Eventually she got to the chapter on the practice of ancestral worship and put two and two together. Jennifer goes on to quote the Bible verse where Jesus speaks to Peter, saying, "On this rock I shall build my church, and what you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and what you loose on earth, it shall be loosed in heaven as well." So what happened from there, you might ask? Jennifer and her husband met with the new pastor and held a prayer session where they verbally told the spirit of ancestral worship it was forbidden from entering the church, and that it never return in Jesus' name. After that, they were instructed by God to renovate the building. This put them at odds with the rest of the congregation, as the old plaques would be consequently torn down. Though, with each plaque torn down, it was recounted that everyone could feel a shift as if power had been slowly chipped away from something that had been holding those places. Acting on this took several years for the people seeking to reclaim the church as a place of prayer and dedication to God, but eventually they were successful. And it just goes to show that even if you are aligned with God and seek to serve his will, no matter your zeal, things will not change overnight. And nothing happens if we are not persistent in prayer. This next part from my notes is a bit less structured, as I recount my encounters with actual demonic possession, the dangers of a cult from what I've learned by talking to others who've practiced it and knowing your enemy, essentially. So, yeah, let's start with we'll start with this, with the first section, what I've seen. I treat possession and other aspects of metaphysical manifestations skeptically because authentic possessions are very rare, and it's easy to mistake a mental illness for a demonic manifestation. And because it's just as common, I've also seen some in the charismatic circles try to write off these illnesses as spiritual gifts, and that's often just as much harm. I myself have only ever seen an actual possession once. I was once on a youth retreat. And on one of the evenings at the camp, after worship, when we broke into groups for prayer, a girl began speaking in a voice that was impossibly deep for a teenage girl. She then began writhing on the floor, screaming as if she'd seen some unseen horror, shrieking, "You can't have her." Needless to say, those of us not equipped for the situation were swiftly ushered out. I remember the concern on the pastor's face as we filed out. I was one of the few people who decided to ask what was going on. The pastor gave some vague mention of demons and closed the door. I remember going to my room and praying for the girl. I didn't even know her name. I just had the urge to do so because, you know, the whole thing felt wrong. I can't imagine that had been good for anyone who was subject to it. I'm sure there were other students there doing the same as well. I prayed to God that he would help her and that she'd be free from whatever had gotten hold of her. Sadly, I can't offer a satisfying conclusion to this story, as the next morning when I asked the pastor if the girl was all right at breakfast, he said she'd gone home, not saying one way or the other if she'd been exercised or if they had to send her to someone who could better help her. And I'm sure I can't be the only one with morbid curiosity about how someone gets possessed in the first place. From my readings, I've learned that it's not something that spontaneously happens, but rather, it's almost like a perverse mockery of being filled with the Holy Spirit. There's almost a deliberancy to it that you have to undergo, dedicating yourself to the devil and his works, much like how we Christians dedicate ourselves to the work of God in Christ. Now, I haven't read much on the subject, and I'm not prepared to speak on that any further. But what I can speak on are the dangers that come with the occult. The Bible frequently condemns the practice of sorcery and such, but it doesn't really explain why. There was a time where I was more close-minded about the occult than I am now, and my brother was slowly embracing the idea of studying it. I told him, that's like taking meth to study its effects on yourself. Don't do that. Initially, he didn't listen, though he did eventually step away from it. And humorously, years later, as you might remember some months back, when I was considering to study it further in the general sense, and I stress study, not practice, he quoted my own analogy back at me, and I was quickly dissuaded after further consideration. Though, this doesn't mean I have remained ignorant. God has granted me with what understanding I need to identify true occultism and separate it from mundane fools looking to get a rise out of others. By observing those who have studied the occult and learning about the consequences their actions have cost them. Taking place in occult practices, even with good intentions, opens you up to the metaphysical. You are especially vulnerable if you have yet to dedicate yourself to God, as his presence acts as a bulwark against anything else that would try to slip in. This is why the Bible warns against occultism and sorcery, like channeling spirits or trying to invoke your will to call forth the supernatural. My dad once practiced the occult for altruistic reasons, and according to his words on the matter, even if you do it for the sake of helping people, the demons will let you think that you are in control so that you will let your guard down and they can more easily ensnare you. He once told me a story about he read about a method to heal others with magic and wanted to try it out. One day at work, with one of his friends sustained an injury, and my dad picked up an apple, channeled his will into it, held it on the wound of his friend, and after taking the apple off of the injury, the wound was gone. He hasn't told me how he went from that to being ensnared by demons, but given how he speaks on of the subject, I trust that he fooled around and did in fact find out. knowing your enemy. The devil is as much a being of persistence as he is a being of deceit. As he's tried to influence me on several occasions, I've gotten pretty good at recognizing him. He may be good at mimicking God's voice, but he's terrible at mimicking God's character. He came to me when I was mentally vulnerable and tried to talk me into ending my life. He came to me when I was at my most calm, trying to get me to pray to the stars in the night sky as I was admiring their beauty. He once came to me trying to get me to pray to him after I was lightly rebuked by God for doubting a promise God made to a good friend of mine. And when that didn't work, he tried to sow the seeds of jealousy in me. The devil will even use things that are good and of God for his own ends, twisting and perverting divine inspiration into obsession and a means of personal glorification. C.S. Lewis put it best when he said there are two common mistakes we make about the devil. The first is to assume he has no power, and the second is to assume that he is all-powerful. Longtime viewers have heard us say that he only has as much power as you give him, but what exactly does that mean? It means that if we take things for granted as part of our lives, they open up the means for the devil to try and bastardize it. You see, the reason we are called to be vigilant is because when we are complacent, we let our guard down. I opened with a recount of my encounter with the Holy Spirit in the context of spiritual warfare, and now I'm going to tell you what happened not less than 5 minutes later. I thanked God for his intercession, and then, my guard down, I went and caved. Yeah. It was humiliating and infuriating, but it helped me realize that the devil often tries to influence us when we least expect it. And when this happens, the best thing we can do is swallow our pride and get back up. The reason persistence so often comes up in the Bible is not just because we must remain faithful to God through good and bad times alike, but also because we are facing an adversary who is even more persistent than we are on our own. Thus is God's intercession necessitated, as it is God that intercedes through the body of Christ on behalf of man. And with that, we come to the end of my notes.
Wow, that's incredible. I know what I mean with this one.
Yeah.
There's a lot over here. I think I can, first, fun fact, earlier Seth referenced how promise of like something with a friend. Yeah, I'm that friend that you saw here.
Yeah.
This works on additional context here. And yeah, the devil's also tried to influence me in several ways as well. This goes all the way back to September of last year, where he tried to get me to lust after someone that I knew, and I basically said, no, I'm not going to do this, and then he stopped. But then, after that, my season of warfare really intensified between up until we started this podcast, actually. And upon starting that podcast, everything from that moment just came to a close. There's been a couple moments here or there ever since there. Unfortunately, I recently had a bit of a bout with a sin I previously conquered. It just happened, like you said, happened when you least expected, right? I was just chilling in my room one day, and then the habit just suddenly came back. Yeah. And now I managed to defeat it again this past weekend, and it left just as quickly as it came. And I think one thing that helped me, oddly enough, was actually reading the Catechism of the Catholic Church, because I was reading a section on the virtues, and there was a part where I talked about how the best way to live a Christian life is to have what you want line up with what you are called to do. Because some people have this view of like white knuckle Christianity where it's like, yeah, I want to do this, but I have to do this because it's what God called me to do. But no, you don't approach it that way. It's just going to make it hard to live your life. What you should be doing is, no, because I love God, I want to do only that which brings honor and glory to Him. Whatever doesn't do that, I don't want to do it. And when it came to this particular sin, I said, no, I don't want to do this because I know it's wrong. I know it will not bring glory to God. I'm not going to do it. And not only did I stop doing it, I lost the desire to do it. I lost the will to do it. I lost the want to do it. It just poofed away. It has not come back since.
You know, that kind of sounds like how I gave up my hatred of people from the Middle East. I don't know if I've told this story on Branch Brothers or To Be Continued.
You told me specifically, but not on here. So go ahead, tell your story.
Okay, so we've mentioned in the past, I used to be affiliated with the alt-right. First out of spite for the left, and then it became because I was just falling down. I was spiraling mentally. I eventually got my head on straight, but there were things that I held on to even after that. And for a while, I was incredibly prejudiced towards people who were from the Middle East. And I knew that this was a problem. One night, I found myself praying to God, saying, God, I need to give this up. I give me the strength to let go. And God asked me, why? Why are you asking me this? And I had to, and I think the reason that he asked me why is so that I could realize why this was wrong. I basically had to tell myself, I had to admit to myself something that I'd been denying for a while. And that's that God made every living being on Earth. Hating someone just because of where they're from or what they look like has no place in a Christian's heart. This kind of hatred will separate you from God. And I knew that. I had to acknowledge that and say, I choose to let go. I choose to relinquish this. And strangely enough, as soon as I said I relinquish this, all that anger I had, all that hatred I had in boiling in me towards people from the Middle East, and especially the Islamic regions, evaporated.
You know, sometimes the best way, I think what we both have in common sense, sometimes the best way to beat sin is just to not want to do it. I know it sounds a bit cliche, and so, but it's so true. In many ways, I've said this before, I think we talked about this too. The unforgivable sin, at its core, is the inability of you to allow God to forgive you. And the solution to not commit that sin is to allow God to forgive you. And it's interesting, because on the one hand, some people think that the being Christian, being a Christian can be the hardest thing in the world, but not because stuff we have is too easy, but because it's too not because it's too hard, but because it's too easy. It's so simple that, like, we're so used to having these complex type solutions that in many ways the solution's right in front of us, but we can't even see it either because we've been stuck in our own cycle of sin, or because in many ways, in the eyes of a skeptic, it might seem too good to be true. But more often than not, the simple solution is often the best one. It's the one you need for that moment in time.
Yeah. I know all too well that feeling of it's too good to be true. That was one of the first things I wrangled with when I was a kid. When I first started to think about the Bible beyond the beyond my children's Bible stories book, I was asking myself, God, can God really be all this forgiving? And you know, it took me years to come to the conclusion that yes,
he is that good, because he is.
At sermon today, Pastor Schultz, the guy who the pastor at the Lutheran Church, was talking about how God can be infinitely merciful and infinitely loving and yet still have godly wrath. And he looks at it like this, that godly wrath is man-made. We basically, because sin entered the world and because mankind has yet to live in a restored world, we are subject to basically pushing the envelope and basically, you know, it's self-inflicted. We are the assholes in the relationship.
Well, the good thing about the situation is whenever God usually doesn't go to the super harsh stuff right away.
Yeah.
I think when you start saying the first time, he usually starts with like rebuke, saying, hey, your bitterness, please come back. It's only after consistent and repeated patterns of sin that God starts to allow more harsher consequences to come in, whether that be a physical exile, whether it be some kind of an accident, whether it be some great tragedy. But the one thing we need to remember is that whenever God allows something to happen, there's only one reason alone that he does it. It's to bring you back, because you've been lost, and he's trying to bring you back home.
Yeah. It's...
In many ways, God is acting like how all good parents should act, where you should love and care for your children. And yeah, when they do wrong, you punish them. But at the same time, you do it in a way where they know that you still care for them, even in spite of this punishment. That you're not, you know, doing it to be a jerk. You're doing it because you want them to be back on the right path. You're trying to call them back.
Right. And, you know, I know we talked about love some weeks ago from like a Christian perspective, and that was actually an angle of it that I had completely neglected to talk about, is the kind of love that that leads you to call someone to turn away from their mistakes. There seems to be this notion in this day and age that if you love someone, that means you basically don't criticize their actions. You don't call them to like change course if they've made a mistake. And that's not really love. I don't even know what to call it.
At best, I'll consider it enablement, since you're enabling bad behaviors by not intervening. At worst, it's basically abuse, because you know that someone's doing something wrong, but you're choosing not to do it. In my opinion, that's just as bad as doing the act in the first place, because you were in a position to help that person, to get them out of that funk. And by doing nothing, you are doing them a great disservice.
Yeah.
Like, that would be the equivalent of, like, somebody had got shot in the street, and instead of taking it to the hospital, he just drove off and kept driving away so nothing was going on. Now, I know that might seem a bit extreme, but the point is, when you know you are called to do something right, don't be afraid to do it. Even if the person gets mad at you for calling them out, at least you did your part.
Right. You know, one of my favorite quotes from Doctor Who is actually, the Doctor defines, the Third Doctor said that courage isn't like doing what is right on its own. It's being afraid and doing what's right anyways.
You know what? This whole situation reminds me of something that happened in Ezekiel, where God's talking to him about, like, how he should deliver prophecies. And he basically says, you know, there are certain people that are going to be doing something bad, and I need you to call them out. And he basically had four different outcomes, where he says, if you tell someone that something bad's going to happen, they don't repent, and they don't change, their blood shall be on their own heads, because they were warned, but like they chose not to listen. However, if someone is doing something wicked, and they perish, and you didn't tell them, their blood will be on your hands, because you failed to warn them.
Yeah, makes sense.
And then conversely, with a righteous person, you know, If you warn a righteous person on the right path and they repent and they go on the righteous way, nobody's blood is on anyone's hands because you saved their life through your intervention. But if a righteous person dies because you failed to warn them, again, your blood will be on your hands. The whole point, and again, this kind of ties to the idea that, like, when you're called, whether by God or the Holy Spirit, to do something, and you're afraid to do it because that's what you're called to do. And sometimes being a Christian means doing things you don't want to do, things that might seem hard, things that might be terrifying, but we still do it because the alternative is always much worse.
Yeah, I mean, imagine what happened if I bailed at the last minute because I was afraid to do the first episode of Branch Brothers, because that almost happened. That almost happened.
Yo, that's right. For those who don't know, on the very first episode of our show, which is right for over 30 episodes at this point, this man to my right, this man to my right almost killed the show before it was about to start.
Yeah.
Had it not been for God himself, we would not be here right now.
Yeah, what effectively happened is I was so nervous. I went into my bathroom, splashed some water on my face, and I asked God, do I really have to do this? I don't want to. And he asked me why, and I'm like, I'm afraid I'll mess this up. I'm afraid I'll be laughed at. And he's like, really? And that flat response of really just made me realize how trivial, how stupid it was to be afraid of that.
Oh man, I saw that dude from Final Fantasy X with the laughing scene.
Yeah.
Oh man. But in all seriousness, that doesn't surprise me. That sounds like something God would say. Like, I can't remember where it was. There was one book where, like, someone was telling God, like, oh, something on the lines of, I don't know if I can do this. And his response was basically something on the lines of that, where it's like, why? I called you to do this. Or it's kind of like with Jonah, when he tried to run away, he had to get eaten by a fish to be set on the right path. And even then, he barely did it. But he did it.
Yeah. Well, we've been at this for an hour and 10 minutes now. I think it's time we roll into worship.
Yeah, this is great. Let's do this.
Let's get the display up and running. Where did I put it? I have far too many items on this list. There we go. Now to make sure that we have... Okay, documents, worship songs. Let's do This Is the Day for our first song. Assuming it'll load. It's just sitting on a blank screen right now. Huh. There we go. All right, now let me make sure I'm capturing the audio correctly. No, that's the wrong one. Open with media player. And then ensure that audio capture is coming from the... Where on earth is it? Oh, here we go. All right. Audio. No. No. Yes. Okay. We got that. Actually. Now, let me see why it's capturing Discord and not... Or why the display is showing Discord and not the song. No. Okay. There we go. I think I found it. No, not quite. There we go. Let me just adjust this real quick. Sorry about the technical setup. Let's get it started. Ow! Loud!
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad. Praise to the Lord, for God is good, whose love endures forever. Let all the children of Israel sing, God's love endures forever. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Oh.
Rejoice and be glad. The right hand of God has struck with power. I shall not die, but I shall live
and proclaim the works of the Lord.
This is the day. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad. The stone that the builders rejected has become the foundation of our house. By the Lord has this been done, our wonderful tune behold. This is the day. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad. Let us rejoice and be glad.
All right, I apologize for the slideshow crashing. That was not anticipated. Hopefully we can work around that and avoid that in the future. Let's move on to our second song, and we will do... Where did I put it? Let's do... Go Make a Difference. Yeah. We'll start that from the first slide. And we will open the song with Media Player. Oh, wait, before I do that, better make sure that OBS, that you guys can see it. Okay, yes, good, good, perfect.
Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. We are the salt of the earth, called to let the people see the love of God for you and me. We are the light of the world, not to be hidden but be seen. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. We are the hands of Christ, reaching out to those in need. The face of God for all to see. And we are the spirit of hope, we are the voice of peace. So go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. So let your light shine on, let it shine for all to see. Go make a difference in the world. And the Spirit of Christ will be with us as we go. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. difference in the world. Go make a difference in the world.
All right, that was Go Make a Difference. Let's move on to our third song today. Let's do... let's do Perseverance of the Saints. Start from first slide. Make sure that it is capturing correctly. Yes, yes it is. Good. And we will open the song in Media Player.
Let me drown in an ocean of devotion. Let my joy be in service and let my emotion. Let me be closer than your right hand, tighter than your left hand. And let me be a godly man till the day I die, till the fire's just smoke. I will go for broke till my last words are spoke. If I limp, then I will run with a limp. I'll win some and lose some, but I'll make my attempt. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. I will keep fighting to the knockout, even if I'm knocked out. Hitting hard, I'm hit before the bell. My soul will keep going till my body buckles. I will drop my bloody knuckles, carry us to heaven by the truckfuls. I will be as stubborn as a pit bull, neutral as a Nazi, resolute like Gandhi. I will keep reaching till I'm took out, till I'm heaven in route. No sellout! Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. Let me drown in an ocean of devotion. Let my joy be in service and let my emotion. Let me be closer than your right hand, tighter than your left hand. And let me be a godly man. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus. Last breath before the candle flickers out, I will speak the name of Jesus.
All right, and that was Preservation of the Saints. Now we will move on to our fourth and final song. And after our fourth song, I will close us with prayer. Let's do... well, that's strange. I have a slide here, but I don't have the song. I don't remember deleting it either. Odd. Okay. Instead of that one, let's do... you know what? Let's do the calling. Here we go. Start from first slide. Ensure that it's capturing correctly. Yes, good. Let's open the song in media player.
I've seen the other side. It's not what the world wants you to believe. Oh. I've traveled far and wide. I've learned that things aren't what you perceive. But it's just life. Take it all in. Ride. Keep running for the light and looking for a sign. The planets will align because you have the calling. Keep running for the light and looking for a sign. The planets will align because you have the calling. When all the lights go out and it's impossible to find your way, we start believing doubt and all our weaknesses are on display. Keep running for the light and looking for a sign. The planets will align because you have the calling. Keep running for the light and looking for a sign. The planets will align because you have the calling. For the light and looking for a sign, the planets will align because you have the calling. Keep running for the light and looking for a sign, the planets will align because you have the calling. Keep running for the light and looking for a sign, the planets will align. Cause you have the calling. Keep running for the light and looking for a sign. The planets will align because you have the calling.
All right, and that brings us to the end of worship. Let us pray. Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our transgressions, as we forgive those who've transgressed against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power, and the kingdom, and the glory, always and forever. Holy Father, thank you for another wonderful day. Thank you for the opportunity to share your word with those around us. Thank you for empowering us to stand firm against the enemy when the enemy tries to shake our faith. Help us be faithful and walk on the path you have set before us, never straying, being ever faithful to you. In your name I pray. Amen. God bless you all. I hope to see you all tomorrow for the game stream that I plan on doing and the To Be Continued podcast later that same day. I'm going to try and get us back into a normal routine. It's been chaos since that hurricane and starting trade school. I know. We've at least kept consistent with that. Let's see if we can fix the, let's see if we can get back on track for everything else, though. See you all around. God bless.